really.
I only went to public school for 16 years.
Back.
Okay.
We're still waiting on two members, but y'all, Martha, can come on back.
Thank you, Daddy.
It seems kind of crass the way they sell those names. I'm glad Tech won. It would have been embarrassing. They had not won a bowl game since 2004. That's right. My wife was a big Tech fan, so she was pissed. But she was unhappy with Georgia.
They don't have a bowl, I hope so.
I went to Georgia myself.
Makes for an interesting season.
That's right.
Yeah. We all want to speak in terms of Thanksgiving.
You can get these license plates that say, well, like half Georgia, half Texas.
House divided.
House divided, yeah.
Yeah.
Timing is everything.
Yeah, good to see you.
Good pleasure to see you again, George.
How are you?
Good to see you.
Thanks.
I'll take this delay. Is this my spot?
Sure. Whatever you'd like.
Thank you very much.
Danny also accepted, I presume?
Yeah, don't look at the news.
Trust everybody. Christmas.
Too short, other than that, isn't it?
Great way to start the new year.
That's right. Georgia won yesterday, so I was right with the world again. That's right. Are you still winning?
I'm sure. In fact, there wouldn't be a new one that you can see the statue.
Oh.
Okay. And it wouldn't be a new one because they were sold out.
Recording perspective on it.
Did you read it?
Yeah, we'll give her one more minute just to give Mr. Van Zandt another minute. It's not as bad. You know, why don't you just check with him real quick? Then we'll know whether to go ahead and just start now. If it's almost here, we'll give him.
Academia. So now I teach at a school. It's called talked with the vice chair personally.
Oh, yeah. Is that over?
It isn't.
Okay.
Would you like to go to school with us?
What? You get a mail order degree?
We do. No, I do. They don't. We do have all our courses on.
Yeah.
Let me see your pajamas at your school. It's not fair.
Aren't you across the street?
He is on his way.
Yes.
We are.
Did he give you an ETA?
No, yeah, I just thought it was.
I don't know any details, but I'm thinking that it's diminished.
How many students do you
have? We have 1,300.
So, classes there?
We have on-campus classes. Of course, even our Atlanta students are likely to be on courses. It's just to get them out. We do have on-campus. It's a commuter trip, a whole commuter. So, it's a good school. Very impressive. Administration is coming in.
Yeah.
Academically.
It's very strong. So, it's a good team.
It did. It began in Jackson.
Why don't we go ahead and get started? Mr. Van Zant can join us when he gets here. We'll start the recording and we'll go ahead. Are we good?
Good.
Okay. All right. Go ahead and call the meeting to order. Just to quickly recap, we have Mr. George Weaver here as counsel. Normal counsel has had to recuse himself on this particular investigatory review that's part of today's meeting, and we're waiting on Mr. Van Zant, who should be here shortly. We have Dr. Rusty Ricketson, we have Lauren Quire, we have Tim Perry, and myself, Bob Charles. We also have Kathleen Eccles, who's our clerk for the board. So with that, we'll call the meeting to order, and ask Dr. Ricketson if you could lead us in invocation.
Father, we're grateful for this day. We're thankful for this new year. We pray your blessings upon it. This meeting, our county, our state, our nation, and Lord, the world. So, Father, we submit ourselves to you. Give us direction. Give us clear minds to think correctly about these matters, that we might do that which is pleasing to you and just for others. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. First order is adoption of the agenda. I believe everybody has a copy of the agenda in front of them. Since we're going to just adopt the minutes from the last meeting, and then we have the investigatory review of the complaint filed by William Dunn against the DA, Mike Mahoney. That's the only things on the current agenda. Anybody have any discussion or additions to propose to the agenda? All right, I get a motion to adopt as stated.
So moved.
The motion, we have a second. All in favor? Okay. Carries unanimously with four members here. All right. Adoption of minutes from the meeting of May 4th. Everybody was provided a copy of those minutes ahead of time. The only thing that I saw, and which I've already noted to Ms. Eccles, is that my name was mentioned twice at the beginning, attendee, so that's a small enough technicality, we can simply strike one of those on the signed copy. Anything else, any other discussion? Has everybody had a chance to review the minutes?
I move the minutes be adopted.
Motion. We have a second to adopt the minutes. All in favor? That's 4-0. All right. And that brings us to the investigatory review of complaint filed by William Dunn against Assistant District Attorney Michael Mahoney. I believe everybody's been provided with all the initial information packet on that. I think just for the record, I'll state, so we have it on the recording, this particular Board of Ethics was virtually disbanded, I think, back in the middle of the year due to the pending change of makeup on the board, which has subsequently been passed, where a panel of attorneys will be seated to manage ethics complaints moving forward. This particular complaint occurred before that took place. Members of this board, some of whom the term had originally expired, were asked to resit for this one complaint only. So the hearing of this complaint, and if there were any pending hearing that came out of this, would be the last item of business, essentially, for this particular board before the new makeup is changed under the rules in Forsyth County. So just have that on the record kind of going forward. I do appreciate very much everybody's interest and willingness to reassemble to hear this complaint so that it did not fall into a gray area between those board changes. With that, I think, as I have reviewed the material that's been presented by Mr. Dunn, there are two principal things that I think we need to at least begin with in looking at. And the first, I believe, is brought up in the response, which is whether, in fact, the assistant district attorney falls under the purview of Forsyth County's code of ethics versus perhaps the state. In other words, is that particular office and its officials, even within the purview of this board, from an ethics perspective? So I guess I would ask Mr. Weaver for your commentary and interpretation on that.
Okay.
Just note for the record that Mr. Van Zandt has also joined.
Apologize.
All right. As Mr. Charles has noted, the complaint alleges that an assistant district attorney engaged in conduct that should be the subject of discipline. This had to do with pending criminal charges and a plea bargain that was struck. A defendant had been indicted on four counts, felony counts, and as a result of a plea bargain between the defendant and his attorney on one side and the assistant DA, Mr. Mahoney, on the other, apparently the defendant was allowed to plead to a misdemeanor. And the ethics complaint says that this was inconsistent with representations made by the assistant DA about how the case would be handled. So the DA has filed a response on behalf of Mr. Mahoney and said that the assistant district attorney is not a county employee but a state employee. And let me pass out a copy of a decision in the Georgia Court of Appeals here. This case states, if you look at the tab and the highlighted language, that the district attorney and the district attorney's employees are considered employees of the state. And there are two other decisions of federal courts in Georgia, at least two, that say basically the same thing. It's a little bit fuzzy because there's a statute, I don't have extra copies, but there's a statute that says that in some cases an assistant district attorney is a county employee. This is code section 15-18-14. But that code section says that this applies to assistant district attorneys who are hired to prosecute cases under the Uniform Reciprocal Enforcement and Support Act. So code section 15-18-14, subsection A1B says that assistant district attorneys hired for that purpose are considered county employees. The indictment here is not for a violation of that law, the Uniform Reciprocal Enforcement and Support Act. There's no indication in any of the materials I've seen that this particular assistant DA was working as a county employee under this code section. So I think you have to go back to this decision that I passed out. This is in Ray Lawrence County, April, June 2001, and July, September 2001, grand jury, 267 Georgia Appeals 204, 2004 decision, which says that assistant district attorneys are considered state employees, not county employees. Of course, under your ethics ordinance, you only have authority to discipline county employees, not state employees. So that's one point. Another point that I think is not raised by the district attorney in response, which should be made, the Georgia Supreme Court has said in a series of decisions that only the Georgia Supreme Court has the authority to discipline attorneys for their conduct in the practice of law. And I've got a copy of one of those decisions, not all of them, for you to take a look at. This case is Stevens versus Thomas, 257 Georgia 645, 1987 decision of the Georgia Supreme Court. And it says in the language that's highlighted, the discipline of attorneys is solely within the province of the Supreme Court of Georgia. And there are other decisions that say the same thing. And for example, Carpenter versus State, 250 Georgia 177, says, the Georgia Supreme Court says that matters relating to the practice of law, their discipline, suspension, and removal are within the inherent and exclusive power of the Supreme Court of Georgia. So you've got these two issues here that you need to consider in deciding whether you have authority to let this complaint go to a hearing. And looking back at your ethics ordinance, what you're supposed to do, as I understand it, is decide whether you have information that's admissible in evidence from affidavits submitted based on personal knowledge that is specific, substantiated information from credible sources that are sufficient to support a reasonable belief that there's been an ethical violation. If you don't have authority because this assistant DA is a state employee, not a county employee, or if this is a matter involving the discipline of an attorney for conduct in the practice of law, then it seems like you can't conclude that there's a violation and you should dismiss the complaint. And it's not one of these situations where under your ordinance there's a technical deficiency that can be corrected.
All right. Well, and I will certainly say that as I looked at it, you know, not being an attorney, it is a bit of a gray area with regard to the state. Certainly, the district attorney's even letterhead has state of Georgia at the top of it. On the other hand, the DA's office uses Forsythco.com email addresses and generally sign their correspondence as Forsyth County District Attorney. So I can certainly understand where a layperson would potentially believe that to be a county function. On the other hand, we certainly have to go by what the actual legal definitions are with regard to whether this person is in fact under our purview, will be even act at all. I guess that's probably the initial thing we need to address. I'll go just one step further in what I read through. You know, the issue that would come before us, in my opinion, is one of an ethical violation as opposed to perhaps a procedural violation or a technical violation. I personally did not see anything in the submission that was overwhelming that an ethical violation was occurred. The only thing I could conclude that could be an ethical violation would be if, in fact, it could be demonstrated that a decision was politically motivated, for example. Beyond that, I personally was not impressed with the plea bargain. I'll say that based on the evidence I read. I'm sure I didn't read the entire evidence from both sides, but that is purely a prosecutorial discretion type of decision, as I understand it. So I guess I didn't, just to kind of further what we're discussing, I didn't find anything in what was submitted that led me to overwhelmingly believe there was an ethical violation.
perhaps some procedural in the apparent lack of contact through the victim witness program. But again, nothing that I saw is intentional. That's again just my reading. Anybody else have any thoughts on either of those two issues?
No, I tend to agree. An overwhelming ethical violation didn't jump out at me, but I'll tell you exactly what did. Being a lawyer, immediately I recognized that, it's up to the Georgia Supreme Court to discipline lawyers, not us, and I don't think we could even take action if we wanted to.
That's kind of the way I read it as well. Let me ask Mr. Van Zandt and Mr. Weaver as attorneys, what would be a normal course of action for a victim or a victim's family who felt that they were, treated improperly or either procedurally or by what took place? What is their normal redress course of action to go through with this?
I just do civil, so I'll defer to you.
Well, in civil or criminal, I've been a prosecutor. If a person's unhappy and you think that an attorney has committed an ethical violation, you make a complaint to the state bar. There's a whole procedure for doing that.
What about the state board of ethics?
I don't think so. I think it'd be the state bar. See, the state bar is considered, quote, an arm of the Supreme Court of Georgia. And the discipline of attorneys for what they do as attorneys is handled that way. Under the, like the Stevens case I gave you.
Right.
Okay. And the website is gabar.org, and it'll tell you how to make a complaint right there against an attorney.
So Georgia State Bar is able to meet out certain disciplinary actions,
sure,
against attorneys that are found to be lacking in their...
Yeah, they do it all the time.
The State Board has an ethics department, so you go to the State Bar Ethics.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that website would tell you how to make a complaint. I think they've got forms on the website.
You know, with all due respect to the Dunn family, and I'm sure if it were my daughter, I wouldn't be happy either. But I don't think that we're the body that needs to hear this. I don't think we have jurisdiction based on what you're saying, based on the case law that you presented. I just don't see where we have jurisdiction over a state constitutional officer.
Does everybody generally agree with that? Anybody have a different perspective on it? I think, and we can even potentially form this as a motion, we would not be sitting again as a board, but perhaps at least as a suggestion to either the county attorney or the board attorney. I think it would be good to maybe outline cases like this, perhaps even a list of officials that would be subject to Forsyth County Board of Ethics jurisdiction versus those that wouldn't, so that folks are not potentially wasting their time filing something that is not of this board's purview. So we may want to, I'll formulate that as a motion after we're done with this, but we may want to kind of give folks a little direction. Because I certainly think this one in particular is a bit gray in what I think people would assume might fall under the county law impacted clause in the state. Any other further discussion on this before we put it to a vote? All right. I would make a motion that we dismiss this complaint. Primary reason being that we are not, it's not under our purview to hear a complaint, not this complaint against a state official, and that all of the associated law appears to say that the assistant DA falls under the state's jurisdiction and not for Forsyth County's. Do I have a second?
I'll second the motion.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor? Carries unanimously. That dismisses the complaint. I would further move that we at least send recommendation to County Council and Board of Ethics Council to potentially draft a list of officials who are subject to the jurisdiction of the Forsyth County Board of Ethics. That would be beneficial even under the new panel's makeup moving forward. That we try to publish something like that potentially on the county's website that we've already begun putting together. that's my motion. A second.
I'll second that.
We have a motion and second to direct a recommendation to the attorneys to draft some language for the general public. All in favor? And that carries unanimously as well. I believe that concludes all the business on the agenda for today. Is there any anything else?
Can I say something, please?
We generally, in investigatory reviews, we don't take comments, but we'll go ahead quickly. If you identify yourself first, please.
My name is William Dunn, the complainant here. And I want to thank y'all for coming back in off of retirement to hear this case. So thank you very much for what you've done for the county.
Thank you very much. Sure. Appreciate it. Appreciate the comments. All right, with that, do we have a motion for adjournment? We have a motion for adjournment. Second?
Second.
Motion second. All in favor? This meeting is adjourned.
I need you all to sign the minutes, please.
Yep.
And I need to send a letter on this.
Yes, please.
I don't have to do that.
I know.
So they walk away. Yeah. Okay, well, I'll
thank you for these.
Yeah.
I'll put them with the file.
I'll let you look at it first.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that'd be great.
All right. Thank you, Kathy.
Okay, thank you.
Bye-bye.
That's a wrap, Kathy. Thank you very much.
You're welcome, Nydia.